Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bitter Pills, The Global War on Counterfeit Drugs by Mohammed H. Zaman. Narrated by Matthew Boston. Author's Note. While from a technical standpoint, counterfeit and substandard refer to different problems, in many sections of media and popular press, the term counterfeit is used as an all-encompassing term and is most commonly used to describe the problem of bad drugs. The title of this audiobook uses the term counterfeit as a reflection of the general discourse on the problem. Prologue. I never knew what the D in D. Watson Chemist stood for. The D. Watson Chemist and Drugstore was a store in a bigger market called the Supermarket, in the heart of Islamabad. Islamabad in the 1980s was the sleepy capital of Pakistan, and also was my hometown. Was it related to Dr. Watson, a trusted friend and the narrator of Mr. Holmes' achievements in Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's classics? Or was it referring to something else? Some said that it was part of a foreign chain, which seemed unlikely because there were very few foreign chain stores in Pakistan, and almost none in Islamabad. Some felt that the store was owned by some local Christian family, but the Christian community in Pakistan is not particularly well off, and most do not have a foreign-sounding last name. Watson would not be a Christian name in Pakistan. Ultimately, I gave up and never figured out what the D was for, or even who Mr. or Mrs. Watson was, and what was the relationship of this name with a store that was operated and staffed by Pakistanis. But D. Watson was a very special place. In a town of about 200,000 people, and one that was known to fall asleep by 9 p.m., Dr. Watson was open until late. It had bright white lights that lit up the whole store. The staff was efficient, knowledgeable, and courteous. This is where one would find the elite of Islamabad fill their prescriptions. This was also the place where the foreigners, who were part of the diplomatic mission or were part of various NGOs, purchased their medicines. The store had drug brands that were familiar to the foreign clientele. It also employed staff that could make do in English. To the Islamabad residents of the 1980s, Dr. Watson represented everything that was right with the West in our minds. It was polished, well-stocked, well-staffed, and very clean. The foreign name gave it an aura of mystery and authority. More than anything, it had one priceless commodity that it cashed in every day: trust. The house that I grew up in Islamabad, was not particularly close to D. Watson. Yet we went there more than we went to the pharmacy that was a lot closer to our house. The drive to D. Watson was a bit of a ride, but that didn't matter when it came to getting important prescriptions filled. We would get the aspirins and the cough syrups at the store that was closer, but if it was anything serious, it had to be at the D. Watson Chemist and Drugstore in the supermarket. The vaccines, if needed, were almost exclusively bought at D. Watson. There was no question of going anywhere else. We weren't among the elite of the city, but the brand mattered to my mother. I grew up with that assumption that some chemist stores are better, more reliable, and more trustworthy than others. Some sell good products, others don't, and they all operate in the same town. In my mind, this was the natural order of things, a hierarchy of quality that allowed coexistence. For me, it represented an equilibrium between the good and the bad, and a marketplace of health commodities with a spectrum of quality. It was much later in life, after I had moved to the United States, that I realized that it was not supposed to be this way. I remember when I asked a friend which pharmacy was better in terms of its products. He had no idea what I meant. I tried multiple times, and then he and I both gave up. Whether I was in Athens, West Virginia, or Russellville, Arkansas, or Chicago, or Boston, the Tylenol was the same, and so was the quality of prescription medicines. The pharmacy in the inner city had the same quality of drugs as the one in the most exclusive neighborhoods. But this was not how it was supposed to work. There was no spectrum of quality here. Something, did not quite add up. This audiobook is an effort to find answers to the questions I have had for so long about trust, technology, and why quality is so elusive. 1. Cities in Crisis. My cell phone rang on the morning of January 13, 2015. On the other end was a friend who had worked in the non-governmental organization, NGO, sector, and who was aware of my research work in Ghana on testing substandard and counterfeit medicines. With a sense of panic in his voice, he asked me if I had read the news about the central medical stores in Tema, near Accra. I hadn't. He told me that the entire facility, with all its supplies and medicines, had burned down, the cause unknown. He suspected arson. My heart sank. Tema is only 25 kilometers from Accra, but the conditions of the roads make it a much longer journey. The poisonous mix of traffic, accidents, and road conditions made it a half-day journey when I visited the place in March 2014. During our trip, we were greeted warmly by the manager of the facility, who had shown us stacks upon stacks of medicines and other medical supplies. The supplies ranged from boxes of medicines to patient beds, vaccines to baby formula. There were even new shiny Japanese cars parked in the parking lot, ready to be used for various Ministry of Health services. A significant number of medical supplies were donated and had colorful stamps and logos in foreign languages showing the origin of the donating agencies and their country affiliations. Some materials were also purchased by the government and had reached the facility at Tema through various customs points. Beyond the parking lot, with the shiny vehicles, were a set of large warehouses which served as the storage facility for medical supplies. Our host, the facility manager, walked with us, found a key that matched the lock, and opened the warehouse for us. The warehouse was a large structure with high ceilings. From the outside, it looked like an impressive facility. But as we stepped in, it painted a different picture. This brick-and-mortar structure was in a state of disrepair. There was no power, and we had to rely on a few rays of sunlight to find our way between the mazes of boxes arranged in rows. Light was the least of the problems we had, compared to what we were about to experience. The much bigger problem was the stifling heat, which had amplified due to lack of ventilation. I looked at the temperature app of my phone to see that the temperature was reaching 95 degrees Fahrenheit. There were lots of challenges at the facility, and the manager of the facility wanted us to look at them firsthand so we could understand his frustration and the challenges he faced on a daily basis. This was my only trip to the central medical stores in Ghana. While central medical stores are found in much of sub-Saharan Africa, they are a remnant of the colonial era. The original idea was to have central facilities and storage sites for maintaining control and distribution in a highly centralized system of government. These were also the points that coordinated arrival of shipments from the colonial powers in Europe. For the colonists, it was much easier to send or sell supplies to a central point than deal with the complexity of local markets. Most central medical stores in Africa date back to the early or mid-20th century, before the countries gained independence. In Kenya, for example, they date back nearly 100 years, when they were established in 1915 as headquarter medical stores. Going through various stages of evolution and incarnation, the term central medical store in Kenya was christened as such in 1970. Today, they are called the Kenya Medical Supplies Authority. Similarly, in Mauritius, they date back to 1945, before the independence of the country. In Sudan, they date back to 1935. Most have not only retained their form in one way or another, but also have grown over time. Like in Tema, most central medical stores are now located outside the city in industrial areas. Central medical stores serve as the nerve centers and main storage facilities in many African countries, where drugs are stored and logged before they reach the markets or provinces. After arrival at the dock, The drugs arrive at the medical store, and while some are sent for testing to national labs, most are not. They are also sites for implementation of various disease management programs funded by international donors. The drugs and medical supplies, through an internal demand and procurement process, reach various provinces, and the process continues down to the district level. Ghana has long been considered a model for peace, harmony, and stability in West Africa. It is a stable country in a region that is marred by violence, civil war, long dictatorships, and most recently, terrorism. Being an English-speaking country, Ghana was where my team and I have worked for the last several years. The central medical stores would have been the central location to pilot the technology we have been working on, to test drug quality before the drugs make it to the market. This would have been the site to see if we could detect the quality of drugs before the public was put at risk. Now, it was all gone. The loss of the central medical store in Ghana meant the loss of not only millions of dollars worth of drugs, but also the main mechanism by which drugs enter the country and are logged, albeit in a system that still relied on paper and old ledgers. In the absence of this store, there was no mechanism by which legally procured drugs could enter this stable country. There has been some progress in determining the cause of the fire, now widely believed to be arson, but many important questions remain about motivation, collusion, and lack of security. This lack of transparency affects public trust in the system and leads to conspiracy theories and the spread of misinformation, issues that further hurt the ability of governments to safeguard drug quality and build confidence in its methods. A similar call had interrupted my morning in January 2012. This time, the story was about Lahore, an ancient city in the northeastern part of Pakistan. A city of art, learning, food, and music, Lahore is the cultural center of Pakistan. A mystery illness had started to kill patients at a public hospital in the heart of Lahore. Patients at the Punjab Institute of Cardiology started dying toward the end of December and early January. The deceased came from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, were largely dependent on the government healthcare program, and had been getting the said medicine from the hospital for quite a while. Families were shattered as their loved ones started dying mysteriously. Among them was Ashiq Hussein, a loving grandfather and a man known for his kind manners and a big heart, who died due to inexplicable causes. He was ill, but no one expected him to die suddenly. Prone to conspiracy theories, the media first blamed it on the sinister elements in the society. Terrorism was also a possibility, given Pakistan's recent history and the lack of security available to the common folk. Some others suggested links to India, the archenemy to the east, with whom Pakistan has had three large and countless small skirmishes. Some doctors suggested that this was arsenic or heavy metal poisoning, since they suspected something was not quite right with the way patients were reacting to the treatment. The numbers continued to swell, reaching near 200, while the cause remained a mystery. The pressure from the public and the media was intense. Buckling under this pressure and the public outcry, the government of the Punjab province, Lahore being the capital of the Punjab province, decided to send samples of the drugs that had been given to the patients to the United Kingdom for testing. The local drug testing labs were not trusted, and their results, some argued, could have been manipulated by the government. Mystery shrouded the entire process, with some experts questioning the governance of the province, while others were unsure of why the samples were sent abroad. Eventually, it was determined that the cause of the adverse reaction was due to contamination of the antihypertensive medicine, Isotab, with an antimalarial medicine, pyrimethamine, leading to deposits of the antimalarial in the bone marrow of the patients. The detailed reports submitted to the courts suggest that up to 14% of the antimalarial was added to the drug, a lethal amount given the patient's history and their ailments. The drug in question was manufactured by Afroz Pharmaceuticals, a reputed company based in the port city of Karachi and a hub of local drug manufacturing. During the early days of the crisis, the company executives were put on the exit control list, Pakistan's version of a do-not-fly list, to stop them from leaving the country. But quietly, after a couple of weeks, the names were cleared. The Federal Investigative Agency had also blocked the company website, which also came back online not too long after the incident. The drug company is now fully operational, and no one quite seems to fully understand exactly what penalties have been imposed, or what happened to the ones that were being imposed. Just as with the initial scandal, the events post-investigation are shrouded in mystery, misinformation, and confusion. The exact cause of why the drug supply was contaminated is also unclear, and points to a breakdown of internal checks and balances, as well as a lack of seriousness in maintaining quality control on the part of the manufacturer. To investigate the matter in detail, a World Health Organization, WHO, team, along with local WHO representatives, created a tribunal, talked to dozens of people, and analyzed the evidence. They also visited the facility in Karachi, looked at the existing safety checks, and also analyzed the quality assurance methods in the public sector. The report provided detailed evidence regarding how barrels of white powder of the two drugs, which look similar, got mixed up. Some of the technicians suspected things were not quite right, and while they did point that out and tried to raise an alarm, the upper management did not act appropriately. The problem at Afroz was not with intentional falsification or an intent to deceive the patient, but with a breakdown of checks and balances. This breakdown was not just at various points within the pharmaceutical company in quality control, but also with the public authorities tasked with testing drugs. Despite major lapses in safety, quality assurance, and adherence to best practices, they had been given multiple clean slates during inspection, including some not too long before the incident. The government of the Punjab province and the federal government in Pakistan, in response to the crisis, or perhaps in response to the public outrage of the crisis, also tried to create various agencies and task forces, but large-scale measures to improve quality are still pending. A few months after the Punjab Institute of Cardiology crisis, another crisis erupted in the same city of Lahore and the nearby city of Gujranwala. This time it was a cough syrup, Tyno, that was associated with the deaths of dozens of people. In addition to Lahore, people also died in Gujranwala. The exact number of those who die in a country like Pakistan can never be known because people bury their dead quickly, and any culture to investigate the cause of death remains non-existent. This crisis was too close to the previous one, in time and geographic proximity, and put significant pressure on the government. In order to deflect attention and show that it was not the fault of the public health department, the government initially blamed those within the urban slums, who are among the poorest in the country and belong to minority Christian groups. The position of the government was that these slum dwellers were addicted, and because alcohol is not easily available, in order to satisfy their substance addiction, they were overdosing on the said syrup. The slum dwellers were an easy target, with their little political representation, poor image, and minimal support among the civil society in Pakistan. Blaming the victims, particularly the poorest of the poor, is not unheard of in Pakistan. This is particularly true for those who may be indulging in practices such as addiction or substance abuse that are looked down upon in society. The official government line to blame the slum dwellers was quick, well before any investigation or postmortem was carried out. Yet this time, there was a quick reaction, particularly on social media and from the family of one of those who had died. The brother of the dead man challenged the government's narrative, and his position went viral on social media. The government then changed its position and took a more ambiguous line, promising a serious investigation in the near future. The government hoped that with time and a new crisis emerging somewhere else in some other part of the country, people would forget. They were right. After investigations by both Pakistani and UK authorities, spurious ingredients were detected in the syrup. Though the test reports were never made public, the government blamed various groups, from manufacturers to opposition, for blowing the situation out of proportion and jumping to conclusions to malign its good performance. Little has been done since to understand the cause of the problems. The problem of counterfeit drugs is not just a problem of low-income countries and large urban cities in these nations. Cities small and large in more affluent countries are not immune either. Cape Cod, Massachusetts, swells with tourists during the summer and shrinks into itself during the winter. Most folks who live on the Cape year-round cobble together a few jobs to make a living. They rent houses and sell ice cream in July. They scrub boat hulls and paint bathrooms in January. In this way, 45-year-old David Nalen was much like his neighbors in East Falmouth, except his side job was far more profitable than most of theirs, and it was illegal. Nalen ran a thriving business buying counterfeit Viagra from Hong Kong and selling it on Craigslist at a huge markup. In May 2013, after months of painstaking police work by U.S. customs officials, he was indicted for trafficking in counterfeit goods, and a warrant was issued for his arrest. In July, a quick Google search revealed that Nalen was back in business. Get Pfizer Viagra, 100 milligrams, 4 pills, $40, his Twitter account reads. No generic rubbish, the original and the best. An online search about counterfeit drugs or its adverse effects leads to dozens of stories throughout the world. There is a new story every week. Some are about the harmful, perhaps even deadly effects, and some stories are about shipments of counterfeit drugs with millions of packets of junk in them. In June 2012, one of the largest shipments of counterfeit drugs was seized in Luanda, the bustling capital of Angola. Nearly 1.4 million packets of substandard Coartem, a leading anti-malarial manufactured by Novartis, were seized. To put the size in perspective, this shipment would have been enough to treat half of the annual cases of malaria in the whole country. The fakes were stored in a shipment of loudspeakers that originated in Guangzhou, and the shipment had reached through an intricate and opaque network of distributors and suppliers to Angola. Angola is hardly an anomaly. Neither is Africa alone in its challenges of shipments of bad drugs that reach its ports. Similar incidents of large shipments confiscated in a variety of countries in nearly every continent paint a global picture of complexity that is hard to track. The Angolan consumers interviewed by the Wall Street Journal said that there is a real demand for cheap knockoffs, as sometimes they do work. Some argued that the demand for substandards is in part driven by hospitals running out of stock. The knockoffs are a lot easier to access. While drug outages are usually denied by the authorities, they occur routinely due to the fragmented supply chains. In interviews with consumers and even pharmacists in multiple countries, from Pakistan to Tanzania, Ghana to Nepal, there is never any denial of stockouts, forcing patients to buy drugs from the private sector. Many of the pharmacies, which are peppered around the public hospitals, often carry drugs that were meant to be free for the public but were never registered in the country in the first place. It is not exactly easy to know whether the stockouts are real and due to limited resources and poor management, or artificial, created due to corruption and collusion. Scanning various news items in print, electronic, or social media about substandard and counterfeit drugs can be overwhelming. The incidents are often in different places and point to differing circumstances. Analyses of these stories in various cities point to a number of commonalities, but they also suggest the multifaceted nature of the problem that makes it hard to track. The cities mentioned point to different dimensions of the problem. The situation in Tema points to the challenge of security and safeguarding the supply of essential and life-saving medicines. While that is not the only challenge, the fire in Tema points to both a failure of security and the vulnerability of the model of central medical stores. By creating a central repository, which functions as both the warehouse and the nerve center, The system is precariously balanced on a site that is vulnerable to external threats, terrorism, internal corruption, and other outside factors. It also points to how poor infrastructure affects the ability of the country to maintain a healthy supply chain and ensure its integrity. If, for example, there is complete breakdown of power, the entire stock in the central medical store becomes vulnerable. Vaccines and medicines that need continued cold storage may lose all of their potency, and with that, the investment that has been made to procure these drugs also disappears. With little or no testing available, the same substandard and degraded drugs would enter the market far and wide in the country. While a centralized system may reflect a central donor-centric worldview that is easier to track and manage, it also reflects the vulnerability of the system that is highly dependent on a single site or a few key locations. The central medical stores are also not immune from theft. There are also criticisms about having one central store, close to the capital, which, in the presence of a weak infrastructure and corruption, would mean that towns and villages far from the capital may not see drugs and supplies reach there in due time. The concept of central medical stores is not just about a warehouse that works in a vacuum or isolation. It is inherently connected to the rest of the public health system. The connections between the central medical store to the hospitals and regional medical stores and pharmacies are vital for timely availability and access of medicines. The connection mechanism, even if it is poorly structured, from the central medical store, on the one hand, feeds into the national labs, and on the other, connects to regional sites, hospitals, and pharmacies. In some cases, these medical stores also supply the private sector pharmacies. The central medical store fire in Tema points to a tough and difficult road ahead for Ghana, a path that is uncertain and is being debated in Ghanaian public health circles. Creating a new central medical store certainly is a pricey endeavor, and the utility of all that investment is somewhat questionable. The investment, should it be made, would be in a system that is looking more toward the past than the future. The alternative is not obvious either. A possible alternative may be to have strong regional medical centers and equivalents of medical stores in various regions and provinces. This would require creating systems in other provinces that would have the capacity and capability to receive direct shipments, do some kind of testing, and then release the medicines to the local supply chains. Perhaps more efficient, this is also by no means a cheap alternative. This would also mean bringing some kind of regular testing services and higher quality technical capacity to the regional sites that currently does not exist. Among the various options being debated, this is the road Ghana seems to be taking, though the exact roadmap is unclear. So is the timeline of the next stage. Perhaps a bigger question is what happens in the interim. Would this lead to drugs entering the market that go under the radar? Would the mechanisms that are created in the interim to bring medicines from abroad include sufficient testing? What about poor quality drugs that enter the market, create new pathways for those with nefarious interests, and compromise public health and create long-term problems such as drug resistance? Would those pathways be entrenched in the system and stay like that even after the central medical stores have been recreated? The impact of the loss of the central medical stores is going to be far-reaching, and it will take both time and lots of effort before we fully understand the impact. As the model of central medical stores is repeated in a number of countries across the African continent and beyond, the problem in Tema reflects a broader challenge that can undermine the efforts of the government and international donors in maintaining and safeguarding the pharmaceutical supply lines. The situation in Lahore with the incident at the Punjab Institute of Cardiology also points to a serious crisis, but one that is distinct from the problem in Tema. This crisis is also multidimensional in its origin and impact. First, it points to lack of robust regulatory oversight within the company and in the country. Regular testing within the company and in the public sector is seriously deficient. From various reports and tribunals, it is now clear that the drugs that had reached the hospital did not meet the quality standards that were expected of the company. Contamination of an antihypertensive with an antimalarial shows a deep and serious problem during manufacturing that went unchecked until it was too late. Investigators found that the quality control and manufacturing staff at Afroz realized that something was amiss when their antimalarial had a lower than normal concentration. So not all of the antimalarial from the stock was entering the drug. This was due to the fact that some of the active ingredient supply was missing or had been misplaced. Internal emails suggested that this was raised by the quality control manager on duty to higher authorities. However, this was not given due attention, either because of lack of knowledge, incompetence, or lack of interest in maintaining the highest standards on the part of the higher authorities. The problem was not immediately reported to the regulators, to the suppliers, or to any other organization in the public sector. The staff on duty finally located the source of the problem. A barrel of active ingredient was indeed missing. This correctly identified the source of lower concentration antimalarial. This should have raised some immediate concerns, such as, where did the antimalarial barrel go? Once again, instead of a full-scale investigation, this problem was addressed by quickly replacing the missing barrel by procuring another one. No questions were asked, either. The antimalarial supply reached its desired levels, and all problems were apparently resolved. Not quite, it turned out. The antimalarial active ingredient barrel had, for some obscure reason, ended up in the wrong production line. It looked the same as the active ingredient for the antihypertensive isotab. Here, suspecting nothing out of the ordinary, the manufacturing system used this antimalarial instead of the antihypertensive, creating a deadly cocktail that claimed the lives of over 200 people. The brazen lack of quality control, oversight, and negligence resulted in one of the worst public health crises in the sixth most populous country in the world. The problem gained national and international attention. It was deeply embarrassing for the provincial government that was craving an image of clean governance and transparency. It was also personally embarrassing for the chief minister, Mian Shahbaz Sharif, who is known to be a workaholic and holds his cards close to his chest. There was no minister of health in the province. The chief minister himself was holding that portfolio. Questions were being asked whether he is spread too thin, as he was in charge of a dozen or more ministerial portfolios. Should someone, an expert in matters of health and medicine, be in charge of the provincial health affairs as opposed to the chief executive? The issue lingered for nearly a year in various courts, moving all the way up to the provincial high court and then eventually to the Supreme Court of the country. The offices of Afroz Pharmaceuticals in Karachi were initially sealed, but like other matters often seen in developing nations, other immediate crises took over. Issues associated with governance, politics, and most importantly, national security overtook the news and people's attention. Those who were in charge of Afroz were never charged with criminal negligence. Questions about cronyism, political corruption, and backdoor politics were raised, but nothing happened. Afroz operates today with full license all over Pakistan. Their website claims that they are in the business of producing quality pharmaceuticals. Whether that was a consequence of poor policy, cronyism, corruption, or the unavailability of appropriate field-ready technology that can test drugs regularly is unclear. What is, however, clear is that the drug manufactured, supplied, and provided to the unsuspecting consumers was poisonous and deadly and was not captured by the existing system in place. It therefore points to the breakdown of testing at several key points throughout the supply chain, including within the company. A WHO report, Pathology of Negligence, points to numerous violations of safety codes and basic problems in the company that contributed to a culture of negligence that culminated in the disaster. These problems included the presence of raw materials with finished goods, the contamination of drums with rainwater, among other violations of good manufacturing guidelines. Another dimension of the problem in Lahore is the lack of availability of reliable labs within the country to test drug quality, potency, ingredients, and efficacy. Sending tests to the United Kingdom is expensive and time-consuming and does not create a sustainable culture within the country. Would this problem be resolved if there was better, widely used technology in the country? Would it be resolved if there was better policy in place? Perhaps the most important question to ask is how unique was Afroz? If we are to turn back the clock and go back in time, would we be able to catch the errors and save lives? Or was it inevitable that something like this would happen, with perhaps more incidents in the future, until a major overhaul of the system takes place? The incident in Lahore brings up several other concerning factors. First, an analysis of the incident should be made in the greater context of a society that is highly fatalistic and does not have a custom of investigating hospital deaths. A postmortem is done only in rare circumstances in a society that, for historical and religious reasons, wants to bury its dead as quickly as possible. One can also not deny the fact that many of the patients who died were already sick, and hence their deaths, while sad, may not have come as a complete shock to the relatives, who are poor and on the margins of society. There were some exceptions, like Ashik Hussein, who seemed fine to the family, but he did not represent the majority of the patients. With the large number of deaths in hospitals in Pakistan, this story was unlikely to make the news except for one reason: the sheer number of people who had died in the same ward and in such a short period. The role of media that thrives on breaking news in Pakistan also contributed to the general public finding out about the story. While there are some good guesses, the exact number of people dying because of the scandal is still unknown. It ranges from 178 to 213 in various estimates, largely because there may be people whose condition worsened over the coming days, and they died later due to other complications. There may have been other people who died at home or in the poorer suburbs of Lahore, who never were counted. Thus, it is likely that the number is much higher than the one reported by the government, which itself has been inconsistent in reports. The second problem seen in Lahore and elsewhere is the complete lack of awareness or understanding about the nature of the underlying problem. The responses of the government, the press, and even some experts raise serious questions about understanding the nature of the problem. Pharmaceutical development, quality control, and drug testing are issues that are never discussed in the public domain. In general, scientific literacy is quite low in the country, and quality control is not an issue that is often discussed. Conspiracy and science are mixed together, and occasionally conspiracy theory and nonsense substitutes for science, sometimes even in science textbooks. Homeopathic outlets are considered hospitals, and little information about drug quality, activity, and the process of discovery is available to the public. With the influx of subpar products coming from abroad, particularly from China, people have learned to live with products that are not of the desired quality and that may fail routinely. The poor quality issue is not just with drugs and medical products. It projects itself in all areas of consumer goods, ranging from cell phones to winter heaters and all other kinds of household commodities. There is a general expression of du number mal, translated literally as a second-rate product, meaning something that is not of the desired quality. And the same applies to pharmaceuticals as well. So while there is no fundamental appreciation of the scientific process in drug development or how quality control would work, there is general acceptance of poor quality products. So when the Lahore incident unfolded, there were many immediate reactions pointing to various conspiracy theories and fanciful explanations that had little to do with reality. There also was a proverbial shrugging of the shoulders, and some called it inevitable, because poor quality products are not unheard of in the society. Another dimension is to put the blame on the patient. This was particularly true for the subsequent case in Lahore about the cough syrup. In the Tino case, the blame was squarely placed on the poor residents of the slum who were using Tino as a recreational drug. This blame situation erupted for two reasons. First, There is indeed a group of people, largely urban poor, who use cough syrup and other sedatives as recreational drugs. Second, the government was reeling after the Lahore scandal and concerned about its image and wanted to save itself from a serious embarrassment. Consequently, it reacted quickly. No questions were asked about either the sudden spike in the numbers of the dead or drug testing. In a typical sensational manner that reflects the current news trends in Pakistan, the issue became political before it even had a technical component. The government made it clear that its hands were clean, even before any inquiry was launched. The government backtracked its original blame on the slum residents only after the family member of one of the deceased came forward and refuted the government claims about his relative being a drug addict. The media, which was not entirely supportive of the government, jumped at the opportunity and hence forced the government to start an investigation. The investigation pointed to a complex set of factors, including overdosing, but also did not rule out the possibility of contamination. Fourth, poor quality drugs have an impact on the patient that goes beyond consumption. The incident in Lahore was quickly followed by another incident in the northwestern city of Peshawar, where tens of thousands of interferon injections, needed desperately by hepatitis patients, were deemed of inadequate quality. The chain of blame went up and down the procurement department and the local bureaucracy. A number of officials were either dismissed, placed on forced leave, or charged with criminal negligence. Large batches of interferon, numbering in the tens of thousands, were thrown away. Some contained nothing but dirty water. Because these injections were going to be given at local public hospitals, the sudden unavailability created a severe shortage and forced the already poor consumers to buy interferon at private pharmacies. This sudden and sharp increase in demand resulted in pharmacies increasing their prices quickly because the government has little control on pricing at private pharmacies. The case of poor quality interferon has lingered in Pakistan, reaching the highest court, where the owners of the pharmaceutical company Pharmedic Laboratories, involved in the manufacturing and those involved in procurement, got a stay against their arrest. In late 2015, it was reported that a steady level of supplies had reached the province to become available for the patients at the public hospital. However, it is always uncertain whether the steady supply is sustainable or at the mercy of the next crisis. The situation in Cape Cod, and in many other parts of higher-income countries, suggests a completely different and evolving challenge emerging from online pharmacies, internet commerce, and peer-to-peer sales that go under the radar. In these countries, the life-saving commodities are usually well-regulated and not typically at risk. But the impact on health from buying knockoff Viagra or an herbal supplement can still be substantial, and the financial impact to the drug manufacturer is certainly noteworthy. Pfizer estimates that the annual cost of Viagra through black market and counterfeit trade amounts to millions of dollars in lost revenue. The exact impact on health is unclear and varies, depending on what the counterfeit actually contains. It can range from no effect to serious side effects that may require hospitalization. The trail of where these counterfeit drugs are made, how they reach the market, and who is behind them is varied and complex. Viagra may be the most commonly counterfeited drug sold on the internet, but it is not the only one. Counterfeit Cialis, Valium, Xanax, and Lipitor are traded routinely online. Similar challenges exist about dietary supplements and herbal supplements that may contain nothing but paint or chalk. With the growth in internet commerce around the world, it would be naive to think that the problems are only in high-income countries. Recent studies and news reports suggest that online pharmaceutical sales are picking up in Russia, India, China, Brazil, and several other countries in Latin America, pointing to further challenges in maintaining drug quality. From a big-picture perspective, the problems of substandard and counterfeit drugs can be classified into four broad categories. The first one is associated with regulation, policing, and consumer protection. Are countries and regulatory bodies complacent or complicit in bringing change and addressing the issues? Do the countries have strong enough laws to prosecute those who are found guilty? This issue, while central to improving drug quality, is extremely complicated to enforce. The time between the first seizure of a shipment or a batch of poor quality and a trial can range from several months to over a year. Sometimes it takes nearly 2 years before the case comes before a court. Often, after long litigation, the end result is a minor fine or a suspended sentence or a mistrial. In Kenya, for example, the fine after a first offense, proved after years of litigation, may just be a few hundred dollars. For a company or a distributor that deals in tens of millions of dollars, this would not even register as a serious fine. The policing issue, which should start with manufacture and quality control at the development sites, is also complicated for many developing countries that do not produce a lot of their own drugs. Thus, they depend on foreign companies that operate through a complicated framework of distributors and suppliers for their pharmaceutical supply chain. This results in the local government and police having little authority to impose strict penalties, besides license suspension, which is also a rare instance. The impact of the growing influence of China, with African nations in areas other than pharmaceuticals, also affects the ability of the government to impose strong penalties. The inherent corruption in countries, unstable political systems, and regulatory bodies not having a clear, apolitical mandate complicates things. For example, in Pakistan, the process of de-evolution of the Ministry of Health has meant that in the city of Karachi, both federal and provincial inspectors operate side by side, with no interaction between them whatsoever. The federal and provincial inspectors may choose to procure samples from the same supplier, the same pharmacy, or a different one, and they are never required to coordinate with each other.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.